Throughout Lisa the Painful, Brad Armstrong recruits multiple companions that, for the most part, choose to go along with him in his journey to rescue his daughter. Companions that have their own unique personality traits, wants, and stories. Let's take some time and, in sort of chronological order, go over Brad's encounters with this quirky cast of characters. Creator's note, I'm going to be going through things as quickly but accurately as possible in a sort of lightning round of their stories, so I can get to each of them in a reasonable time. Additionally, characters that have been covered in other videos won't be making an appearance here. And finally, there's going to be information for some of the characters that isn't given in-game, but is given by the artbook/website. If you'd like to read those for yourself, the link to that is in the description. But with all that out of the way, let's get started. Atop a lonely mountain, at the edge of a cliff, Brad found a tall man sitting alone. Brad broke his trance-like pondering, and the man introduced himself as Nern Gwan, the greatest historian left in their time. He told Brad that he had a plethora of information about what happened to their home, and asked if he wanted to hear some of the stories. Although disappointed in his enthusiasm, Nern began to recount what he knew of the event he called the Flash. He was sitting with his wife, God rest her soul, sipping lemonade. It was homemade, or, well, he believed it was, but didn't rule out the possibility that she bought it from a store. Then he realized how ridiculous it would be to buy a bottle of lemonade and then transfer its contents to a glass. He wondered if she did that so she could put ice in it, but realized making it homemade would take just as much. In a little bar outside a small town, Brad met a man named Rage Ironhead, a luchador. Rage was the founder of Ironhead Lucha Libre, which was a style that focused around devastating headbutts. After hearing about a girl being found alive in a lathe, he set out to find her, eventually offering his services to Brad for a mere 70 mags, which after procuring the amount, Brad gave to the wrestler to have him join him. Sitting at the bar nearby was a man with a red nose who told Brad he had no interest in mags. He wanted a stiff drink and good memories. Being generous, Brad bought the man a drink, whereupon the man asked him what his story was. Brad revealed he was looking for someone, and the man asked if he was looking for anyone specific, which prompted Brad to leave. But before he could, the man offered his bow to Brad to help him survive the war outside. Plus, he owed him a drink, so Olan Hoyt joined Brad's party. Brad passed through a small gap where he found a wild man wearing furs lying on the ground, listening to a crowned squirrel. This wild man, Beastborn, had lived his entire life amongst animals, and had the ability to understand them, as after the squirrel excitedly squeaked at Brad, the man attacked him. He was defeated in combat and due to his animalistic nature, became submissive to Brad after seeing this display of dominance, and reluctantly joined Brad's party. In Factory Town, Brad noticed a strange-looking man sitting alone. He introduced himself as Mad Dog, and would only say he'd lost his spiked club. Not very long ago, Brad had found a spiked club stuck in the head of a man in a cave, a man that bore a tattoo of M.D. Jr. Could that stand for Mad Dog Jr.? Nonetheless, when Mad Dog saw the spiked club, he merely claimed ownership of it and joined Brad's party, never mentioning the fate of his son. After defeating the men's hair club, Brad found Farty Hernandez, one of the legendary Hernandez brothers, tied up and being mistaken for the girl was being used as the hair club's sexual plaything. Farty promised he could fix the bridge that had been cut out in exchange for being rescued, so Brad collected the man and headed out, stopping along the way to pick up Goldie the hen at the top of a mountain. In a hut surrounded by chickens, her owner, the farmer Rooster Coleman, lived. Since he really only cared to spend his time around chickens, he initially told Brad to leave, but changed his tune when he saw Goldie in Brad's possession. He asked for her return, but Brad held Goldie hostage to get the chicken-loving farmer to join his party. Very soon after, he came to the crumbled bridge where Farty held up his end of the bargain and rebuilt the bridge using tools in the back of his truck. Afterwards, he joined Brad's party, yet remained permanently depressed at the abuse he suffered in his captivity, something not even a reunion with his brothers could cure. Nern explained that he felt a great strangeness well up inside him, something he'd never felt before. It was his rocking chair. It stopped rocking. Upon further investigation, he found a little stone had gotten caught beneath him. After such an exciting day, Brad exited a cave to come out on the wrong side of a man attempting to make a bowel movement. The man apparently needed some encouragement and was trying to talk his way through it when a spider crawled up into his nether regions. He turned to find the source of the tickle and was mortified to see the arachnid. With wide eyes, he asked Brad to kill it, which he easily did. The man was so thankful towards Brad that he instantly joined his party, introducing himself as Percy Monsoon. Besides this rather unique way of meeting, Brad found that Percy was a relatively normal guy that wasn't really unique when he and his group were kidnapped by strange men. They were brought to a warehouse where their captors asked Brad to select one of them to play Russian roulette. The captors only wanted 3 rounds, but somewhat on a sadistic streak, Brad kept playing, maybe even losing some friends along the way. After killing all the men the organizer had, Brad was given a prize and was set free, but was stopped by an enigmatic scarfed man that wore a bucket on his head who forced his way into Brad's party. The story of this stranger was always a mystery, as he never spoke a word to anyone, never even mentioning his own name. So the group took to naming him after his most distinguishing characteristic, buckets. After the harrowing experience they just went through, Brad decided they needed to get a drink. And when they finally found a bar, the bartender told them that the drunk lying on the ground close by had bought everything he had. That drunk was a man named Bertie Hall, who used to be the father of 2 boys, Joey and Jimmy. Tragically, Joey contracted a disease that Bertie couldn't afford to treat on his dock worker budget, eventually leading to his death. Jimmy was unable to deal with his brother's death and committed suicide shortly after. Bertie wallowed here, trying to forget the loss of his family by drowning himself in alcohol. Brad brought the man some whiskey, and incredibly thankful for the generosity, Bertie joined Brad's party, his new family. A little bit further on, Brad found a town where students practiced martial arts under Grandmaster Bob Friday. Coming to the dojo, Brad found it was under attack by a man in a tiger mask. Nicknamed the Dojo Buster, he traveled the land to challenge the powerful to see how strong he was. Next on that list was Grandmaster Friday, who quickly ducked out of the confrontation, which left Brad as the one to challenge the fearsome Tiger Man. Luckily, there were some in the village that could help. A feline-loving warrior named Yazan Bargodi joined Brad when he promised to help him find a paradise for cats, and a young magician named Jack joined when he was given new playing cards to perform with. With their help, Brad was able to defeat the Tiger Man, who, impressed with his ability in battle, also joined him to continue getting stronger. On the way to construction, in a small inn, dwelt Olathe's serial killer Geese Thompson. He attacked his victims with devastating pecks, and the police were left with no suspects because Geese was terrible at taunting them. On each of the bodies, he left a poem, meant to lead the police to find him, but his writing skills weren't very good because in that goose mask or hood was a mind that was pretty dim. Now he spends his day in this inn rhyming to anyone that'll listen, and if Brad listens to his rhymes as little as 5 times, then Geese would choose to join him. Clearing out some rubble after finding some TNT, Brad explored a cave where he found a scantily clad man named Garth. Garth explained to Brad that he used to be an artist, but he's now resorted to drawing promiscuous images of women to make ends meet. He asked Brad for a donation of 150 mags for reference materials, and was surprised when Brad handed them over. In exchange for this kindness, Garth offered his services to Brad, who found that his mastery of the drawn image was able to evoke powerful emotions to any who had seen them. Brad then collected a seemingly discarded duffel bag on a ledge nearby, then continued on to Skulltown, where he met a couple more men that joined him. Clint Olympic, who with his cut body and flowing blonde hair was now regarded as the most handsome man alive, joined after being paid 500 mags, while the Punjabi playboy prince Ajit Mandeep joined Brad simply for admiring his abstinence from using the joy drug. With these new companions in tow, the group made their way deep into muddy waters, where an establishment known as the Beehive was found, which served as a brothel to the men that remained in post-Flash Olathe. The owner was a man named Queen Roger, who was intensely passionate about protecting his bees, and would sting anyone that tried to pull one over on any of them. Brad was able to talk to Roger in his office, where he revealed that demand was exceeding supply lately, and actually asked Brad to help out. After servicing several clients on his own, some of which could be peculiar, Brad asked Roger to join his crew to make up for the work he did, which Roger agreed to, enthusiastic about bashing some heads in. While in the Beehive, Brad also noticed a strange-looking man that was missing something he kept referring to as Duffy. This Duffy was actually the duffel bag that Brad found earlier, and Brad returned it to him. The man liked how nice Brad was, and revealing himself as RT, joined Brad's party. Using the strange contents of his bag, probably accumulated over his lifelong struggle with homelessness, to inflict various statuses against his foes. On the way back through the swamp, Brad accidentally fell in one of the murky pools, where he ended up in a strange village made up of fishmen. While exploring it, Brad picked up a sea map on a table, yet in doing so, he angered a couple of the nearby fishmen who knocked him unconscious. He was woken up by another fishman that was different from the others. He introduced himself as Harvey Alabaster and told Brad he was his fishman lawyer and that Brad was in fishman court. What followed was a fierce defense by Harvey, who often crossed the line and insulted the fishman judge and his family under the guise that it was coming from Brad. Surprisingly, it worked, and Brad walked out of the courthouse a free man. Feeling like they were a perfect match, Harvey invited Brad to be his partner so the two could continue to work cases together. Earlier that day, Nern's wife, God rest her soul, made potato salad for this barbecue, even though he was more of a mashed potato guy. When they arrived, Nern made sure to distance himself from his dumb potato bitch wife, because he didn't want to be associated with anyone that brought potato. The sea map that Brad stole was to a place named Garbage Island, where, after a short trip, he found it was indeed an island made of garbage. The uncredited creator of this strange place was a former accountant named Fly Minetti, who was the greatest at the activity the denizens of this island used to pass the time: kart racing. Wanting to try it out, Brad jumped in a cart and beat everyone he faced, including Fly. The loss devastated him, and Brad convinced him to come along with him so that Fly could train to become stronger, eventually surpassing Brad. Having only touched the edge of Garbage Island, Brad delved deeper into it, eventually coming to a lone establishment named Ollie's. Inside, he found the sweaty owner, who was surprised to see a customer. Ollie explained that he bought this place from a city slicker that obviously ripped him off. Hearing how he got lost in trash when he tried to leave and of his magazine debt made Brad pity the man, and he offered to pay off Ollie's massive debt of 2 mags. This crossed one person off of Ollie's list of debtors, and ecstatic, he joined Brad's gang. Returning to the mainland, Brad remembered a strange green paste he bought at the Fishman Village, and recalled seeing a man with a fish mask that spoke in that same strange dialect. This man, Carp, used to run an orphanage for abandoned kids, using his fish mask to let them know it was okay to be different. But after the flash, he didn't see any use in giving false hope to children anymore. He left the children in the care of Morris Dinkle and set out for the wasteland. When Brad offered the green paste to Carp, he chirped a word of fishman and joined Brad's party. As Brad descended from Nern's, he eventually came face to face with the man again, who started telling Brad about a real kooky day he had at the doctor's office. It all started when he was in the waiting room reading a teen magazine. He was reading it because he saw Ulysses Utensils. The group continued through more perilous adventures until coming to a makeshift wrestling promotion named the Eternal Wrestling Championship. Brad jumped at the opportunity to take place in the promotion and started as a doubles competitor with a wrestler lower on the card named Shock Lord, who often messed up his entrance and missed his attacks. Brad embraced his partner, and the tag team stable known as Armshock took the promotion by storm, eventually winning the tag team championships together, proving that Armshock would never die. Afterwards, Brad tried his hands at singles competition and climbed the ranks to win the Eternal Title Belt. This got him expelled from the promotion due to his non-compliance with the bookie's wishes. His expulsion was a fate that was shared by another former wrestler, Sonny Baklowitz, who was forced into retirement due to his violent outbursts emerging with his unsettling relationship with his large dog named Harvey. Sonny, now wearing the pelt of the long-dead Harvey, spent his time muttering to him and only acknowledging the strong. When he saw the EWC title on Brad, he joined the champion to help in his journey. It was a journey that took him towards the peak of Snow Mountain, a section of Olathe held by the warlord Buffalo Van Dyke. Long before he became the ruler of this mountain, Buff was a vicious American football player that was adored by the people, but after he discovered the source of corruption in his league, he was released from his team and had his eye torn out of its socket. He retreated here, where he gathered followers in an attempt to relive the glory days of his past. Yet after he and his gang were defeated by Brad and his team, he left the weaklings that he used to run with to be a part of Brad's stellar teamwork. Crispel Daddy was a fierce warrior that had the awesome ability to wield 3 swords in each hand in battle. Yet even with this insane talent, he couldn't prevent his lover, Toby, from being kidnapped and carried away to Han Tsunami's bathhouse. As Crisp wallowed in the stone village, Brad approached him and revealed that he had rescued Toby from Han's bathhouse, but wouldn't return his lover to him unless he joined his party. Crisp would do anything for Toby, so reluctantly agreed, yet always harbored a hatred for Brad for blackmailing him. And that's when he noticed he was wearing two different kinds of socks. Nern admitted he was excited after telling all of these stories, even though Brad was a bit of a bore, and decided to join Brad since he had many more tales to tell, and Nern Gwan joined Brad's party. Each and every one of these characters, no matter their disposition towards Brad, eventually met their end either at the hands of Brad when they tried to stop him from chasing after Buddy, or in the chaos that occurred afterwards, bringing an end to their stories. And that was the lightning round of the Companions of Lisa the Painful. If you feel like one of your favorites wasn't gone into enough depth, I'm incredibly sorry, but I was trying to keep things quick and simple, yet still accurate to their story. I hope you understand. If you have any other questions or comments or anything, please feel free to share. I'd be happy to hear from you. But that's it. So, thank you for watching and see you later.